Thank you. Our scripture for today's teaching comes from the book of Exodus. Afterward, Moses and Aaron went and said to Pharaoh, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast to me in the wilderness." But Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and moreover, I will not let Israel go."
Thus says the Lord, "By this you shall know that I am the Lord. Behold, with the staff that is in my hand, I will strike the water that is in the Nile, and it shall turn into blood. For this time I will send all my plagues on you yourself and on your servants and your people, so that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. For by now I could have put out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, and you would have been cut off from the earth. But for this purpose I have raised you up to show you my power, so that my name may be proclaimed in all the earth."
Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand toward heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, a darkness to be felt." So Moses stretched out his hand toward heaven, and there was pitch darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. They did not see one another, nor did anyone rise from his place for 3 days, but all the people of Israel had light where they lived.
But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let them go. Then Pharaoh said to him, "Get away from me and take care never to see my face again. For on the day you see my face, you shall die." Moses said, "As you say, I will not see your face again." This is God's word.
Boy, that is a tough passage to ask. It's like Children of the Corn or something. Okay. We have been looking at the life of Moses from the book of Exodus, and to catch you up on where we are in the story, the Lord appeared to Moses and told him to go to Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and say, "The Lord says, let my people go so that they may worship me in the wilderness." And yet when Moses delivers this message to Pharaoh, Pharaoh is unmoved. And so we come today what for filmmakers, for Ridley Scott, is the most interesting part of the story, an evocative part of the story, but what for readers is the most disturbing, perhaps even terrifying part of the story, and that is the plagues. The Lord sends 10 plagues on the nation of Egypt, and we're just sort of going to be hovering over the first 9 of those plagues today, Exodus chapters 7 through 10. And I should say from the outset, this section of Exodus may capture why some of you walked away from the faith, or in fact this morning believe you can't call yourself in good conscience a Christian because of stories like this one in the Bible, where it appears like God is sending down judgment on those who don't know Him. We have defined faith as confidence grounded in reality. If that's what you believe, that life in Christ is life grounded, not in subjective opinion, but in reality, then that claim must be open to any challenge, including in this case, what is the deal with these plagues? Why is this in the Bible? What does this have to teach us about who God is? What does this story have to teach us about the life of faith? Well, the key line in the story is back in Exodus chapter 5. When Moses first goes to Pharaoh, he says, this is chapter 5, verse 1, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, let my people go." And listen how Pharaoh responds, verse 2. But Pharaoh says, "Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and moreover, I will not let Israel go." "Why should I listen to what you say?" Pharaoh says. "You say, the Lord says, but who is the Lord that I should obey him?" Now, I want you to look at that question because it's not just Pharaoh's question. Who is the Lord that I should obey him? It's not just Pharaoh's question. It's very much the same question many people and some of you are still asking today. Who is the Lord that I should obey? Obey has become a bad word in our context. It implies subservience, a restricting of freedom, a certain not thinking for yourself. So this question, who is the Lord that I should obey? This is very much our question. And it's the question these plagues set out to answer. It's the question that stands behind these 10 plagues. That's why in almost each of these 10 plagues, you'll find some version of the line repeated. This is chapter 8, verse 10. So that you may know, this plague has come so that you may know there is none like the Lord our God. Or another example, chapter 9, verse 14. For this time I will send all my plagues on you yourself and your servants and your people so that you may know. There's none like me in all the earth. So the Lord wants Egypt to know, but not just Egypt. You have to remember hundreds of years have passed between the death of Joseph in Genesis and the birth of Moses in Exodus. That is, the people of Israel were in Egypt for several centuries. It occurred to me this week, more than the age of our country, almost double the age of our country. Israel had been in Egypt under the influence of Egyptian culture and society, religion and values. The ancient Near East was a militaristic context where the power of a god was often judged by the station of his people. So the Hebrews, who had suffered decade after decade after decade of brutal oppression, had to be wondering, are the Egyptian gods more powerful than our God? And they looked around and they looked at their own lives, and it certainly seemed so. So the plagues were a picture not just for Egypt, but for Israel, that the Lord their God is more powerful than any other rival god. To show both Israel and Egypt, indeed to show all the earth, that the Lord alone deserves worship. Why does the Lord alone deserve our worship? First, because God alone is king. Second, because God alone is wise. And lastly, because God alone is a merciful judge. We're going to trace those threads through this story. Why is God worth your worship? Why should you bend the knee to the God of Jesus Christ? Because he alone is king, he alone is wise, and he alone is a merciful judge towards you. But let's start with maybe the most controversial. Why should you obey? Who is the Lord that I should obey? You should obey because he alone is king. The Lord alone is king. Now, I understand that's a wildly unpopular, a certainly controversial claim. Isn't that sort of thinking you might say that is the cause of all the religious violence we have seen and see in the world today? Well, if you stick with me, I'll show you why at the end of this sermon, Jesus offers an unparalleled resource. Jesus offers an unparalleled resource for peace in our city, our nation, and our world today. Much stronger than the bland, let's just go along to get along. That won't give us the peace that collectively we're all seeking. Why is Jesus our best hope for peace in our city, in our nation, in our world today? But let's start with what these plagues unapologetically seek to convey. The Lord alone is God and there is no other. And let's frame it this way. Why are there 10 plagues? I mean, if God knew the 10th plague was going to be the one to break Pharaoh's back, why not just start with the 10th and be done with it? And for that matter, why these particular plagues? Now stick with me for a moment, just follow it. If the plagues were simply meant to demonstrate brute power, certainly something more impressive than frogs, that was the second plague, Egypt overrun with frogs, that's Exodus chapter 8, featured in the film Magnolia. Frogs in the mixing bowls, frogs in the oven, frogs in the palace. Now that's gross, but it's hardly awe-inducing. Why frogs? And the ninth plague, darkness. Why darkness? Because the plagues were not random manifestations of divine power. The plagues were carefully chosen. See, there were no atheists in Egypt. There are probably, percentage-wise, as many atheists in Egypt as there are atheists in America today. Not many. Egypt was a wildly spiritual, polytheistic place. Pharaoh did not believe in the Lord, but Pharaoh was not an atheist. Pharaoh was a pluralist. He was a pluralist. You've got your God and I've got mine. In his case, about 80. Now, this is interesting. It means that Pharaoh, 3,000 years ago, is not too different from my Uber driver last week. See, that's the thing about getting stuck in a car with a pastor for 45 minutes. You're going to get my best shot. And you're trapped. You're trapped. I sit in the front seat. You're trapped. But I'll have to say, and I hope my driver's here today because I invited him and I prayed that he would come. And I have to say, he was so curious and he was so kind. And we had a long discussion in Wednesday afternoon traffic. And he said, isn't it possible that Jesus is Lord for you? And I'm glad that works for you, but that doesn't mean he's Lord for me. And that's fair enough and a very common response. But don't you see, that's the same seat Pharaoh was in. You have your gods and I have mine. Why should I acknowledge yours? And in Pharaoh's case, hey, my gods are powerful. The Nile, the earth, the sky, the sun. Or in my Uber driver's case, I'm not sure what I believe, but why should I accept what you're saying? Well, back to Exodus. The plagues were carefully chosen to show how mistaken Pharaoh was. How mistaken Pharaoh was. The plagues were carefully constructed one by one to unravel and expose the emptiness of Egypt's entire religious system. Each plague was surgically directed at something they considered sacred. All of their deities clustered around the Nile, the earth, the sky, and the sun. And each of the plagues was directed accordingly. What was the first plague? The Nile. The Nile. Worshipped, and so it's tainted. What is the second plague? The frogs. Why frogs? Because one of their goddesses was named Hecht. Hecht was the goddess of fertility. And Hecht was always depicted with a frog's head. Always depicted with a frog's head. So a plague of frogs that were everywhere, including in your bed, that would not be good for fertility. So frogs everywhere. But the most significant deity in Egypt was the sun god, Ra. Each morning, Ra won a victory over the demon of darkness for another day. That's why the ninth plague, which is so strange to us. But did you notice the line? This is Exodus 10, verse 21. And the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand toward heaven that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, a darkness to be felt. You ever notice that line? A darkness to be felt. What does that even mean? A darkness to be felt. The Hebrew scholar at Berkeley, Robert Alter, describes it as, quote, the claustrophobic palpability of absolute darkness. This is a supernatural darkness. Not even a candle was lit for 3 days. And you might think, all right, it's dark, but what's the big deal? When you read over these first 9 plagues, you might think to yourself, I would much rather sit in the darkness than have lice. That's the third plague. Or I would much rather sit in the darkness than have boils. That's the 6th or 7th plague. But do you see why this darkness, this plague of darkness, was the most terrifying plague yet? Because their most powerful god, Ra, their most powerful god was rendered impotent. So the first answer to Pharaoh's question and my Uber driver's, why should I obey this god, the one whom you say you represent? Because he alone is king over all the earth. Now, that is a wildly unpopular claim, but it's the unapologetic punchline of the story. Psalm 72, verse 11 says, may all kings fall down before him and all nations serve him. And that's still true today. May all kings fall down before him. So that's why you should obey him, because every king should. There can only be one throne. That line of reasoning by itself, all that may do is harden you. The Lord alone is king. So another reason to obey, the Lord alone is wise. The Lord alone is wise. The oldest definition of wisdom, the definition the Greeks often used, wisdom is skill in living. Skill in living. So when I say the Lord alone is wise, it doesn't mean no one else has any wisdom. It means the Lord knows best how to live your life. And how do these plagues demonstrate the Lord alone is wise? Well, it's hard to see this on the surface of the story, but once someone points it out to you, you can see it stitched through these plagues. But commentators from across the centuries have pointed out the plagues are an unwinding of creation. The plagues are an unwinding of creation. You see the unraveling of the order given to creation in Genesis chapters 1 and 2. Exodus chapter 7 through 10, that's the plagues, are an unraveling of Genesis chapters 1 and 2. Here's how one writer, Peter Enns, puts it. He says, the plagues are creation reversals. Animals harm rather than serve humanity. Light ceases, darkness takes over. Waters become a source of death rather than life. Each plague is a reminder the Lord creates and rules over all nature. For example, you remember right at the beginning of the Bible, Genesis chapter 1 and 2. Genesis chapter 1 verse 2 reads, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. See the darkness? Darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. See, there's darkness, there's chaos, darkness over the face of the deep. And then the Spirit comes, next verse, and brings light. Let there be light, order, and peace. Now, this is precisely what is lost in the ninth plague. Light is lost. Darkness once again comes over. There is chaos. The earth returns to pre-creational chaos. Now, you say, well, that's interesting. So what? It's showing you that God orders all creation. It's showing you that there is a fabric. There is an order. There is a moral grain to the universe. And when you violate that, when you go against the grain of the universe, there is upheaval and chaos. When you go against the grain of the universe, there is a moral fabric to the universe, and when you go against it, there is upheaval and there's chaos. Now, you know what I just gave you? I just gave you the plot line for every Coen Brothers film you've ever seen. I'm serious about that. No matter what crazy thing happens, no matter what crazy things happen, there is a moral order to this universe. And when you go against it, your life unwinds. You can trace that through every film the Coen Brothers ever made. Why should I obey? The Lord is saying, because when you disobey, when you don't listen to God and honor God's way of doing things, you are unleashing chaos in your life. When you don't honor God's way of doing things, you are unleashing chaos over your life. Now, if you don't believe that, look around. Just look around. The TV show Justified, the Deputy U.S. Marshal Raylan Givens asked his ex-wife, who keeps trying to do things her own way, as he does too, incidentally. She gets in one mess after another, and he asks her, how's that working out for you? How's that working out for you? Sometimes that's your best response to people who say, why should I listen to you about Jesus? I just prefer doing things my way. Sometimes your best response is, how's that working out for you? One of the most powerful arguments for turning your life over to God is when you are face to face with where your own best thinking has gotten you. How's that working out for you? Upheaval in your life doesn't mean God doesn't love you. It means God is your maker. And so when you go against your maker, you're going against what you were made for. So no wonder your life is not working. You have unleashed chaos over your own life. We talked about this last week in reference to the Ten Commandments. That God's law is not arbitrary. It's not, I said it, you do it. God's law is not given in a vacuum. In Exodus, it's given in a story. After he brings the people out of slavery, the Lord says, I've given you so many reasons to trust me. to see that I'm good. So then now obey me. God's call for you to obey him is not meant to oppress you. It's meant to free you. Because God created every part of you. Not just physiologically, God created you holistically, emotionally, spiritually, every part of you. A life that flourishes is a life that is in tune with God's intention for you. That's a second reason to obey, not just because God alone is king, but because God alone is wise. And when you go against the moral fabric of your own nature, you are disintegrating your own life. You're unleashing chaos and darkness over your own life, and it hardens you. It hardens you. Now, I need to talk about this because when you read the Exodus story, there's a theme you keep coming up against, and quite frankly, it's troubling. It's this phrase about the hardening of Pharaoh's heart. The Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and he did not listen. Heart, when the Bible talks about the heart, it's a much richer word than what we hear when we hear that word. Heart in the Bible doesn't just mean your feelings. It's the center out of which you live. It's the center out of which you think, act, and feel. So a hardened heart means Pharaoh was becoming calloused to God. His heart was becoming arrogantly inflexible, increasingly stubborn. The hardening of Pharaoh's heart. Now this is fascinating. That phrase, hardening of Pharaoh's heart, that phrase is used precisely 20 times. In the book of Exodus, the hardening of the heart. 20 times. 10 times the text says Pharaoh hardened his own heart, and 10 times it says the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. Now, which is it? Was the Lord in control over Pharaoh? Did the Lord harden his heart? Or did Pharaoh have free will and choice and responsibility? And over, the Bible's answer to that question is yes. Yes, both are true. God is always in control. You cannot thwart his will. That's why we can say, with God, all things work out. But God is not responsible for anything evil in this world. And the text is trying to show you literally, both of those things are true. That's why 20 times, 10 times it says Pharaoh hardened his own heart, and 10 times it says the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. Now, why bring this up? Because what happened to Pharaoh can happen to you. If you refuse to obey God's voice, if God has placed his finger on something in your life and you refuse to obey God's voice, if you keep refusing where you know God is calling you to change, if you keep resisting God's voice and stiffening your neck, don't you see that you are on such dangerous ground? You are hardening your heart. And like Pharaoh, your character is becoming your destiny. Like Pharaoh, your character is becoming your destiny. And for now, God is allowing you to persist in your willfulness. God is allowing you to see the consequences of going your own way. And how's that working out for you? He's allowing you to see that going your own way is only unleashing chaos over your life. So why should you obey God? Because he alone is king. He alone is wise. Now, those first two reasons may show you why God deserves your worship, but that won't capture you. That won't change your life. You have to become convinced that God alone is worth your worship. God alone is worth your worship. You have to want to obey because you are finally convinced that God's way for you is better than your way for you. Now, how will you get there? Well, this is the most compelling reason to obey. Because the Lord alone is a merciful judge. The Lord alone is a merciful judge. And the person who helped me see this is Tim Keller. He points out that the whole point of the plagues is that they were sent to save. Yes, they are a judgment against the evil of oppression and slavery. A judgment our own nation understands quite well. But this is a judgment that leads to salvation. How does that work? A judgment that leads to salvation. Well, it's pretty obvious the plagues are a judgment to save the Hebrews. They become the means of their release. So we'll see next week. This is what God uses for their redemption. But it's not just the Hebrews. The Lord says quite explicitly he wants the whole earth to know who he is. This is Exodus chapter 9, verse 14. For this time I will send my plagues on you yourself, on your servants, and on your people, so that you may know there is none like me in all the earth. Verse 16, but for this purpose I have raised you up to show you my power so that my name may be proclaimed, not just in Egypt, but in all the earth. So the Old Testament story centers around one people group, the Hebrews. But God's ultimate purpose was and is never just about one people group. It was never simply about one nation. It was always about all nations. And the door to that light had to come through one nation, but so that all the world might know there is one God who alone can deliver. So it was all part of one unfolding story, that there is one God who alone can deliver from an oppressor far worse than Egypt and from a slavery far deeper. But here's the thing not to miss. God will use these plagues one day even to save Egypt, even to save Egypt. See, in this story, Egypt and the Egyptians are the enemies of God and God's people. Yes, but God wants Egypt to know who he is. Not so he can just crush them. Not so he can just crush them. I mean, if God wanted to crush Egypt, he could have done it in a finger snap. That's what the Lord says, actually, in chapter 9, verse 15. He says, for by now I could have put out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, and you would have been cut off from the earth. But God doesn't want to crush them. He wants to save them so that they too might know who is the Lord and one day turn to him to be rescued. Now, this is not the last time we hear about Egypt in the biblical story. Years later, the prophet Isaiah says, one day Egypt, this is Isaiah chapter 19, verse 20, it says, one day Egypt will cry out to the Lord, quote, and he will send them a savior. Verse 21, and the Lord will make himself known to the Egyptians, and the Egyptians will know the Lord and worship him, and God will say, blessed be Egypt, my people. Blessed be Egypt, my people. I mean, you should just, that's like, you know, like, that's the big reveal. You know, if you're reading through the story, like, Egypt, my people. This was remarkable. The Lord says, I will strike them down and they will turn to me. Why will Egypt become the Lord's people? Why will they turn to the Lord? Because one day they will see why this God, see, not the Nile, not Ra, the sun god, not even Pharaoh, but why this God alone deserves their worship. Because he alone brings salvation through judgment. That is what is unique about the God who is in Jesus Christ. He brings salvation through judgment. The biblical scholar James Hamilton says, actually, this is the through line of the whole Bible. That's the title of Hamilton's book, God's Glory in Salvation Through Judgment. Salvation through judgment shows you God's glory. When will Egypt see that? When will we see that and turn in worship? Well, hundreds of years after the plague of darkness in Exodus 10, darkness once again came over the face of the earth. On a Friday afternoon, the gospel says, and when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. Darkness at noon over the face of the world. And do you remember what the Bible says happened when Jesus was crucified? All these strange things that we probably have never known what to do with. It says, the earth shook and the rocks split and even the tombs were opened. What's that all about? It's the same pattern of Exodus chapter 7 through 12. Chaos was loosed upon the world. The power of sin was deconstructing creation, except this time, you see, in Exodus, the plagues came down on the enemies of God's people. But on the cross, all the judgment of God came down on one place. Jesus, the Son of God, became the enemy of God. And God's righteous judgment fell on him. Chapter 9, verse 14 of Exodus literally says to Pharaoh, I will send all my plagues into your heart. And that's what happened on the cross. I will send all my plagues into your heart, into Jesus' heart, into God's own heart. This is the ultimate exodus, where darkness settled on God's own form, so that by his mercy, we can know today those plagues will never again come down into our hearts, because they came down into God's own heart. See, that's salvation through judgment. You know what that is? That is a merciful judge. the Lord alone is a merciful judge. See, you are not a merciful judge towards yourself. I think you know that. You may want to be, but you are exacting and unyielding. Don't you see why Christ alone is worth your worship? Not just because he alone is king, and he is. And the Bible says one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And all kings will fall down before him. Not just because Jesus alone is wise, and he is. Jesus' way is always the better way. But because on the cross, Jesus was unmade. His life was split open, blood and water. Jesus, the judge, was judged in our place. The judge who came, but not to judge the world, but so that all that judgment fell on him. He came to bear judgment, not to wield it. Or as Keller puts it, the maker was unmade to remake you and me. Now, back to my Uber driver. He asked, how could there be just one true religion? Isn't it more responsible and even more humble to say that there are many ways to God and that Jesus is just one among many valid paths? A very common question today. But don't you see, if you say to me, how can you know your God is the only God? How can you know? No one can know. Well, if no one can know, how can you know? If no one can know, how can you know that God hasn't chosen to reveal himself in precisely this way that is better and more grand than humanity could have ever invented? See, everyone has a view of spiritual reality. Everyone. Everyone has a view of spiritual reality, even if that view is there is no spiritual reality. Everyone has a view of spiritual reality that you think is preferable, or you wouldn't prefer it. Religious pluralism is attractive, and it seems reasonable. But when it is used to relativize the claims or uniqueness of Jesus, it boomerangs on the one who uses it. It's guilty of the very thing it claims no one should ever say, that one religious perspective is to be preferred over another. You say, I'm not saying that. But you are saying the world would be a better place if we could just accept religious pluralism. So by making that argument back to me, you're doing the very thing you say no one should ever do. So if you say no one can know, how can you know? Everyone has a view of spiritual reality. It's just a question of which view is most attractive intellectually and existentially. Which view is better? So why do I say that Christ, that the Jesus way is the best alternative for promoting peace in this city and in this nation and this world? Because look, becoming a Christian means you have given your life to someone who died for you before you understood him, before you agreed with him, while you were yet his enemy. He was judged in your place. And if that is how you see yourself, how could you ever withhold acceptance? How could you ever stand in judgment over someone else? How could you ever withhold your love from people who disagree with you? When Jesus died for you, not only when you didn't agree with him, but while you were yet his enemy. I mean, if your bottom line is, he made peace with me while I was yet his enemy. He didn't judge me, but he was merciful towards me. Then how can your attitude not be but to love your enemies? And rather than judge them, to listen to people who disagree with you. To listen to them respectfully, patiently, humbly, before they agree with you. And wow, does our nation need that right now? Wow, does our nation need that right now? The ability to listen to those whom we disagree with. Patiently, respectfully, compassionately, humbly. And to work alongside people before you agree with them. Wow, does our nation need that? And more than any other alternative, it's the gospel that enables not only that kind of dialogue, but the gospel offers a way forward for this city and for this nation, for this world. And you say, well, you know what? That sounds amazing to say that Christians should be humble and compassionate and patient. Yeah, where are those people? Where are those people? Were other Christians like that? And my answer to that, and my answer to my Uber driver, my answer to you is, okay, well, be one of those. Be one of those. You don't judge a religion by its followers. You judge it by its founder. And this is what Jesus calls you to. See, what the Lord asked Pharaoh, the Lord asked him, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? That's Exodus 10, verse 3. How long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? The same thing the Lord asked Pharaoh, the Lord asked you. How long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? All you're doing is hardening your heart. All you're doing is unleashing chaos over your life. But here's the great news. What Pharaoh was unwilling to do, you can. You can give in. You can bend the knee, you can believe, and you can obey. Why should I obey the Lord? Because He alone is King. He alone is wise. And He alone is a merciful judge to you. Where else can we go? Well, let me pray for my driver, for myself, and for all of us. Lord, You love us so much more than we love ourselves. Lord, we don't believe that. We think that we know what we need and that we know what is best. Lord, help us to trust that You care about us so much more than we care for ourselves. And Lord, help us to find freedom through placing our lives under Your care. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.